Now, there's two kinds of oils that are produced in plants. The kind that we, the kind that we're going to be talking about tonight are the aromatic oils. They're composed of very tiny molecules. They easily evaporate, and most of them have fragrances, although some of them don't. And because you could be out in the woods and maybe never notice a fragrance, but there's molecules of essential oils in the air. They don't all have a detectable fragrance. But if you get very close to a cedar tree, you'll tell this room, it can give me 50 feet away and smell the cedarwood oil. But anyway, there's two kinds of oils that plants produce. The kind that we're going to talk about are the aromatic ones, and they're little tiny molecules, and they circulate in the plant. They can go from the roots to the stems, to the leaves, to the flowers, and back again. They go down to cellular level and back out. They go through cell walls and back out. And they administer many benefits and functions to the plant to keep it alive and healthy. And they serve many functions for the plant. And those oils, we call them essential oils because they're essential to the life of the plant, and they serve many essential functions for the life of the plant. And they work very well on human beings, which tells me that God was thinking of us before he ever created us. And if you look at there in Genesis, what did he create first, the plants or people? Plants. Plants came on the third day, and it was a couple days later he decided to bring on Adam and Eve. And all of the plants and the oils were already there for him. So he was loving us before he ever made us. That's God. Well, the other kind of oil that plants produce is found only in the seed of the plant, not nowhere else. And it's bigger molecules. They don't circulate anywhere. They're too big to pass. Oh, good. This going to help? Yeah. This help. I might not have a voice. Good. Okay. Thanks. So that kind of oil, we call them seed oils, actually, because they're only found in the seed. And they stay in the seed, and that's where the plants create them. And they never move out of the seed, and the plant that makes them never uses that oil. Now that sounds kind of odd. God, why would God produce something for a plant that's not going to use? Well, when a little plant starts to sprout from a seed, there's a few days in there before it gets roots and leaves and a stem and a circulatory system and can put up its leaves to the sunlight and through photosynthesis and the minerals and the water from the soil. It takes a while before it can manufacture its own food, because plants, they don't have a supermarket. They can't go anywhere, so they have to make their own food. And it's a little while before they can do that, so how are they going to live? That oil in the seed is their food until they're ready to make their own. So that's what God's plan to keep perpetuating the species. He provided for their little baby plant, and the oil is its food. But those oil molecules are too big to pass through your skin or to be breathed into your lungs and to serve our bodies. The essential oils can go right through your skin. We breathe them and it goes into our lungs, into every organ in our body. When you anoint somebody on the head with these essential oils, it goes right through the sutures of the skull, right through the skin into the brain. It circulates through the body. You can even try this experiment. Take an essential oil like peppermint, which is quite fragrant, put some on the soles of your feet, and wait a few minutes, and it'll taste it on your tongue. It goes right up your body. And so we know that these molecules can reach any organ and cell in your body because they can pass through cell membranes and back again, and they provide all kinds of healing and wellness services for us. But those oils don't, the seed oils don't have a fragrance, really. If you took a bowl of corn oil or peanut oil or olive oil and just let it be out in the open, you're not going to smell that all over the room. But as soon as I start opening up these bottles up here, those molecules are going to be from the front of the room to the back of the room in no time at all, because they're very energetic. Now, I don't know what your all backgrounds have been as you grew up. I grew up as a Methodist, and don't hold that against me. Methodists are not into oils, because I found out. I don't get anywhere with Methodists, but that's all right. Anyway, when I was a boy growing up, though, our pastor would sometimes tell us on a Sunday, he said, "Now, next Sunday, I'm going to anoint every one of you." And we thought, "Oh, that's great." Now, what he meant by that was during the week, he'd go to the supermarket and buy some Mazola or Wesson oil or something like that, or maybe even get some mineral oil out of his medicine chest. He didn't understand that when you anoint in a spiritual way, you've got to have the right kind of oil. He just thought it was ceremonial. And then on Sunday morning, we would go up one at a time, and he'd put a little bit of oil on our forehead and give us a blessing. Now, I'll accept a blessing from anyone at any time in any form, but that's not a biblical anointing. In the Bible, when it talks about anointing people, and they can be on their feet, it can be on their hands, it can be on their shoulders or on their head, it talks about pouring oil on you. It doesn't talk about a little dab like that. So I would like to, if somebody would be willing and they didn't mind I mess up your hair, to do a biblical anointing right here. Oh boy, we have a lot of them. Come on up. Let's see. Gloria, could you take one of these chairs and just put it in the center there and face it out? Pull it. I'll need you to hold the microphone. Let's see. Let's move this up just a little bit so I can stand behind you. There, that's good. That's good. Tell me your name.
Yolanda.
Yolanda, yeah, I met you earlier today. Thank you, Yolanda. Okay, I have a bottle of anointing oil here. That's my special bottle. And I'm not going to tell you what's in it because I'm going to pass this around after and you can smell it and maybe you can tell me what's in it. Now there's a little dropper cap in there so that you can only get out one drop at a time. But the Bible says to pour on the oil, so I'm going to take that out. Now in the 133rd Psalm it says that Moses poured the oil over Aaron's head until it ran down his beard and around his vestments all the way to his waist. But you don't have a beard, so I can't But I am going to, let's see, can I take that off? All right. Naturally. There it is. Okay. So I'm going to pour this oil on your head, but I may caution to any of you who are going to do this, be sure it's poured on the back of their head, because if you put it up here and it gets in their eyes, that won't be very pleasant. That's not what they did in the Bible times. So here we go. You know what? That's almost all gone. This is true. Hey, Yolanda, you're getting the whole. Okay, now let's just take that and pass that around and you can smell it and see if you can guess what's in there. Now, if you look at anointing in any biblical dictionary, it's going to say rubbing and massaging. It doesn't say just put it on there. It says actually rub and massage. So if you get an anointing on your feet, that's a foot massage. If it's on your head, you're going to get a head massage like your mother's getting there. I'm going to get a little on her ears. There, there you go. Get on the neck. I'm not going to pull on your earring.
It's not
a carry-on. There. So. Heavenly Father, we call upon you to bless this disciple, this child of yours. She loves to serve you. She would love to serve you even more. Give her a long life and perfect health and lots of energy to serve you. Fill her life with joy. Fill her face with light. And fill her mind with thy wisdom. In the name of the Father, Holy Son, and of the Holy Spirit. That's the second time you were anointed today.
Come on now.
Well, thank you for that. Okay. One more little quick point before I get right into the meat of this. In ancient times, biblical times, Egyptian times, in cultures all over the world before civilization as we know it came about, in the tribes of American Indians or wherever, the people in those tribes and in those cultures who were designated as the spiritual healers were also the priests and the religious healers. The spirit and healing was one and the same, because in those cultures and times, they understood something that had gotten forgotten in the last 1,000 years or so, and that is that God is the only source of healing. And if you don't combine the healing with spirit, you miss the whole point. And that's a problem in today's medical system, because it's an atheistic system. The training is atheistic. And I know I've been to medical school, and I never did hear them mention God or prayer. I have not read any books in medicine that talk about that. And I'm not saying that doctors and nurses are atheists, but they don't have training of how healing really has to connect with God, or it can't be healing. So I'm looking forward to the day whenever spiritual qualifications will be required to be a medical doctor or a nurse or a chiropractor. And there's one medical school I know of that has a little spiritual training, but they don't really get into it very much. That's a place out in California. But I really need to bring that back together again, because how can you have a healthcare system that doesn't know where health comes from or how to restore it when it's lost? Because it only comes from one source. Whenever a physician gives you medicine or surgery, they can do the physical part, but they have to cross their fingers and hopefully pray for the healing to take place. So anyway, I just thought I'd mention that. But I'm ready to read some scriptures. How many of you have a Bible with you? Great, okay. Somebody look up Psalm 45, verse 7 and 8, and then hold that. And somebody else would look up Proverbs 27, 9. Proverbs 27, 9. And somebody else would look up Isaiah 61, 3. Isaiah 61, 3. And then Hebrews chapter 1, verse 9. Just look that up and hold it for me. So let's start with Psalm 45, verses 7 and 8. Who has that can read for me?
Psalm 45, 7 through 8. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore, God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows, and all garments, smells of myrrh and alum and cashew out of the ivory palaces, whereby they have made thee glad.
Okay, did you hear that? An oil of gladness, and named off a few oils, cassia, alum, and a few others. Okay, oil of gladness, keep that in mind. Let's read Proverbs 27, 9. Great, if you can stand up and face everybody.
Proverbs 27, 9. Oil and perfume make the heart glad, and the sweetness of a friend comes from his earnest counsel.
All right, so it said oil or ointments and perfume make the heart glad. Now, back in those days, perfumes and ointments were all essential oils. They actually used the word oil. And so here's another verse in the Bible that's telling us that those oils can make you feel happy. Let's try Isaiah 61:3. If someone would stand up and read that, please. Isaiah 61:3.
To grant those who mourn in Zion, giving them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of the spirit of fainting, so they will be called oaks of righteousness in the Lord, that he may be glorified.
Okay, good. So here's a third Bible verse. It refers to an oil of gladness. Some translations it says an oil of joy. Well, we've got one more verse here. Hebrews, New Testament, chapter 1, verse 9. Do you have somebody can read us that one? Hebrews 1, 9. Thank you.
You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions.
Okay, four verses in the Bible referring to an oil as if it could make you feel euphoric or happy. Well, frankly, when I never did connect feelings of happiness or joy with an oil until I got into this field about 15 years ago. And the only connection I had ever made was when I was a little boy and I'd visit my grandmother and I could smell the oil of chicken frying in the kitchen. That made me really happy, but somehow that doesn't fit the Bible, I don't know why. So, actually they understood something back in those biblical times that we forgot, but have been rediscovering in the last 120 years. The five senses that you have are not all connected to the brain in the same way. Your sense of sight, hearing, touch, and taste are wired to come here to the frontal lobes where you can think, you're conscious, and you can reason. But the sense of smell isn't going up there. It goes under this part of the brain, right behind the nose, into a section of the brain. It's right over the roof of your mouth and under the cerebrum, which is your limbic brain, or your emotional brain. So when you smell something, it's going to get an emotional response before it trickles up here and you can get a rational response. Now that's extremely important and points out a significant difference between essential oils and all other kinds of medicines or pharmaceuticals. Most of our sicknesses and conditions have emotional or spiritual roots. They didn't start out as a physical problem. They started out as an emotional one or a spiritual one, like holding in resentment or bitterness or unforgiveness will eventually result in some kind of disease. And in order to heal those diseases, you need to get back to those emotional roots, which pharmaceuticals don't do. They got tranquilizing drugs, which actually hide your emotional roots from you and prevent you from ever healing yourself, and to cover up those things. But this is real healing. This is not covering up symptoms. And so the oils, when you smell them, can go right back into that part of your brain where memory is cataloged and bring back to your consciousness traumas that you had years ago, maybe as a baby or as a child or as a teenager, that you forgot. And those emotions that are hidden in your consciousness will eventually show up as a sickness. It can be asthma or diabetes or fibromyalgia or even cancer or any number of things. And we have ways of identifying how to use the oils to bring up those feelings and then how to deal with them and bring about healing. But we're dealing with the root causes now, not just the symptoms. And so the oils have that capability, and that's God's medicine. And that's why they're so wonderful and how they can heal so many things that ordinary medicine won't, because you're dealing with the root. So, let's see, do we pass around the oil of joy yet? Yeah, we got a bottle over there and a bottle over here. Yeah. Now let me explain to you, these are, those of you who are familiar with these essential oils and already know they're highly concentrated, and one drop goes a long way, so take the bottle and just tip it over and put a drop in your hand. I'll put this down for a second. Just put a drop in there and then rub your hands together and then cup it over the nose and mouth and breathe. Now don't get your finger in your eyes or anything like that, and even sometimes these oils will irritate your tender skin on your face or if you get on your forearm. Let us know if that happens. I have some
vegetable oils up here that if you have any oil that's in the wrong place and it's kind of irritating you, let us know. We have some vegetable oil that you put on there that takes care of it right away. But anyway, that's how you can enjoy these oils. And so we're passing around the oil of joy and take a deep breath of it. See how it makes you feel. And then when you get through, you can just anoint yourself, just rub it on you wherever. Rub it on your neighbor or something.
So, I think that's interesting that in the Bible they understood this emotional connection and talking about it. Now, tonight be sure we have some pitchers of water over there, don't we? Yeah. Be sure and drink lots of water tonight. You can get some here. We have some, or when you go home, because these oils are detoxifying, and they will stir up toxins in your body. And you want to be sure that the toxins leave by way of the kidneys and the colon, and not by way of your sweat glands or something else, which they can. It's a good thing, but you want to be sure that you can get those toxins out, because those are the things that make us sick eventually. And so we're going to have a cleansing experience. Okay, let's turn over in your notes. Does everybody have notes? Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so you said that most physical illness is a result of emotional illness,
mm-hmm.
and that if we want to go to the emotional, we want to go to the root of the emotions,
uh-huh.
that by inhaling the oils, that takes us back to that emotional level.
We can do it that way for that purpose. It won't always do that. We teach another class on emotional releasing with oils where we teach how to do that. It's not always a case of just smelling the oil and remembering something. But that does work, and we do it all the time. So, let me see here. If you're on page 5 of your notes, there should be a heading there that says 2 blends of biblical oils. You see that? And does everybody have a set of notes? Do we get enough for everyone? Do we have any extra notes, or is...
We're supposed to bring them, download them.
Okay, if you download them. Allie, you got any extra, Allie? If you go to a website, it's the same website where all of my books are available. It's called raindroptraining.com. On the home page, you'll see some of things down on the right side. It says you can download the notes for healing oils in the Bible. You can click on that and you can find them and download them right here. And, yeah, so we do have a few copies. Good. Boy, she's going to make some. Good. Thanks, Gloria. Anyway, if you're on that page, let's look up Exodus chapter 30, verses 22 to 31. Exodus 30, 22 to 31. So as soon as somebody's got that, if you wouldn't mind standing up and reading that to us. 30, 22 to 31. Somebody got that?
I did.
Okay, great. Just read that to us.
The Lord said to Moses, take the finest spices, a liquid myrrh, 500 shekels, and a sweet-smelling cinnamon, half as much, that is 250, and 250 of aromatic cane, and 500 of cassia, according to the shekel of the sanctuary, and a hin of olive oil. And you shall make of these a sacred anointing oil blended as by the perfumer. It shall be a holy anointing oil. With it, you shall anoint the tent of meeting and the ark of the testimony, and the table and all its utensils, and the lampstand and its utensils, and the altar of incense, and the altar of burnt offering with all its utensils, and the basin and its stand. You shall consecrate them that they may be most holy. Whatever touches them will become holy. You shall anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them, that they may serve me as priests. And you shall say to the people of Israel, this shall be my holy anointing oil throughout your generations. It shall not be poured on the body of an ordinary person, and you shall make no other like it in composition.
That's far enough. Okay. So here's the holy anointing oil. The recipe was given to Moses by God himself. And it was, let's see, it contains cassia, calamus or cane is what it said in that translation. It's also got myrrh,
cinnamon.
And cinnamon. And also some olive oil. Now if you take those units, shekels and hins, and convert them to something that we know, like cups and tablespoons, you find out that it's 84% essential oils and only 16% olive oil. So out of that mixture, it's almost all essential oils with a little bit of vegetable oil in it. And all of the anointing oils of the Bible were scented. They were never pure olive oil. And they used walnut oil and almond oil too, as a carrier, we call it. But anyway, if you take those units and figure out what that recipe is for, and how much oil you would have if you mix that many shekels and hins together, you'll end up with 6 gallons of oil. That is a lot of oil. We sell it in little tiny bottles like that. Well, why would they need so much? Well, if you remember what she read there, they were supposed to anoint the altars, everything on the altar, the laver next door, which is the bowl of water they wash their hands in. And they did that every day, and so they needed a lot of oil. Now, that's kind of interesting, because here is a place where animals were sacrificed almost daily, in fact, daily, hundreds of them sometimes, and that would create a potential pathologic environment that could generate lots of bacteria and viruses and parasites, which would result in a lot of sickness among the temple personnel as well as the whole tribe of the Israelites and Hebrews. But the Bible doesn't record any such epidemics. So what was protecting them from such an incident? Well, scientifically, we've studied those oils, the calamus and the cinnamon, cane, and the cassia, and the myrrh. And every one of those is highly antimicrobial. They're the best disinfectants in the world. And by rubbing those oils on all the instruments on the altar and the altar itself every day, they were sanitizing it and prevented the possibility of an epidemic coming from that. So this tells me that God was thinking of more than just ceremonial purposes. He was thinking of the physical welfare of the tribe, of the Hebrews. And it was for their own protection as well. So it's wonderful that God was thinking of those things. Now, they didn't have the science and chemistry to figure out what those oils actually do, but now we do, and it's just marvelous. Now, I want to pass around, did we pass around Exodus 2? Yes, I keep forgetting here. Get that Exodus 2 out. It's a little bottle. Yeah. Okay. This is a blend of oils that's listed in your notes. It contains all 4 of the holy anointing ingredients, but it also contains 4 other ingredients not mentioned. So this is not the holy anointing oil, it's something else. It does, however, contain the ingredients of the holy anointing oil with 4 others. And so I want to also, while we're passing that around, and I should mention that all of the oils that we're passing around tonight are safe to take internally. So if you want to taste a drop of any of these oils, go right ahead. Some of them taste very good. This one does. I like it. But some of them don't taste very good at all, but you're welcome to try them. But let me talk about another oil at this point. Let's get thieves. I want to follow that with thieves. It's another oil. She's going to pass around an oil, and the name of it is called thieves. T-H-I-E-V-E-S. Yeah, like a crook or a robber. That's a funny name for an oil, but here's how I got that name. Over the centuries, there is a bacteria called Bacterium pestis, which
is a result of being in contact with that is you get the bubonic plague. Bubonic plague attacks your lymphatic glands, and so in the glands in your armpits and in your groin and other places in your body swell up, and they turn a dark color. Sometimes they call that the Black Death. And it's a fairly deadly disease. Normally, one out of four people who get it will die. And so those plagues, well, it happened twice that we know of in the Bible that it talks about. It's in the 25th chapter of Numbers, and also in the 1 Samuel chapters 5 and 6. And you won't find the word bubonic. Oh, that's great. Yeah. Okay, that's a little easier. Anyway, the bubonic plague is carried by a bacteria that lives on the intestines of rats and mice. So if you had a lot of rats or mice running around, you could end up having the bubonic plague because the fleas that live on those rodents, if they bite you, that's how you get the disease. It's not if the rat or the mouse bites you, it's the fleas that they live on. They live on them. And the Bible mentions the symptoms, the swollen glands in the right places. It mentions also the plethora of mice that were running all over the place. So it does a good job of describing the bubonic plague without mentioning bubonic. Well, that plague comes back every few centuries in different places in the world. The worst incidence of it in Europe was in 1347. And it lasted 3 years, and 25% of the whole population of Europe died in those 3 years. And people were so frightened that if someone died, nobody wanted to remove the body for burial. They didn't want to touch it or go into the home of somebody that had died. But it turned out, in a couple of those incidents of the plague, there would be people who could rob those bodies and go into those homes and steal whatever they wanted, and they never caught the plague. They seemed to be immune to it. And so one of those several thieves got caught and were taken before the king. And the king told them, he said, okay, you are criminals and we're going to execute you for your crime. But we want to know how you can do this and not get sick. What's protecting you from the plague? And if you will tell us your secret, we will execute you less painfully. So they agreed to that. If you know anything about Middle Ages executions, they weren't fun. They didn't do it like they do today. But so the secret was that when there was no plague and they were occupied in their normal line of work, they were perfumers and spice traders, and they dealt with essential oils. And they knew somehow that those oils would protect them. Now, they didn't understand the germ theory or any of the mechanisms of it, but they knew. And what they would do is take the oils. And by the way, thieves has clove, cinnamon, lemon, rosemary, and
eucalyptus,
thanks. Five oils in it. They would take those oils and put them in a bottle of vinegar, shake it up real good, and wipe that all over their bodies, which would coat their bodies with the oil. And then they would make a mask that had a beak on it, like a big bird. You can see pictures of this in the encyclopedias. They'd fill that full of those herbs or the oils. And so they were breathing them, and that protected them. And there was even the doctors, there was another time the plague came to Europe, and this was in the 1700s, and they had heard about the vinegar that the thieves used, so they used it. And they even got the masks, and so when the doctors could treat their patients at that time, they could be protected from the plague. So for a short time there, the medical profession itself was catching on to these oils. Now,
Let's move on. Anyway, that's how that oil got the name of Thieves. Some of you in here have been using Thieves. How many have been using Thieves? That's kind of, is that a kind of a favorite oil of a lot of people? Yeah, it's wonderful. If your child is going to school and you're worried about the sicknesses at school are going to bring them home, like flu and colds, put some Thieves on the soles of their feet and let them go to school. And then when they come back, have a little diffuser going in your house with Thieves oil, and you won't, none of those will come. And we have teachers who have learned that, and they diffuse Thieves in their classroom, and they hardly have any absentee. The kids just don't get sick. So it's a very practical thing to know about, and you can apply that yourself. If you start getting a sore throat, you can gargle, which I do, and you won't have a sore throat anymore. It just knocks it right out. And we have a lot of products, actually. We have Thieves cough drops, we have Thieves hand wash, we have Thieves bar soap, or Thieves toothpaste, yeah, household cleaner, and a lot of things. But anyway, let's try another oil here. Let's get Three Wise Men. And Three Wise Men is a blend of oils, and it has the ability to stimulate this organ right here in your forehead, called the pineal gland. And the pineal gland, when it's stimulated, will bring you into a state of calmness and receptivity to where you can pray and meditate more effectively. And although the Egyptians and the Hebrews and Catholics have been diffusing these oils in their sanctuaries for thousands of years, they may not have understood why they were doing it. They just knew that whenever you smell those oils, you felt like kneeling and praying and meditating. But it's because of this gland right here. That gland is also the seat of your intuition. And let's see, how many men do we have in here? Several. Well, we are disadvantaged because women have a pineal gland that's twice as big as ours. So when your wife comes up with all these things, you say, how'd you know that? Well, she may not be able to tell you why, but she's got more intuition than you've got. So you've got a physical organ that shows it. And that's your intuitive gland up there, but it's also your meditation and prayer gland. And this blend is intended to stimulate that, so you could rub it right here if you want to. Let's see, are we passing that around right now? It's going. Yeah, put it right there on the middle of your forehead. And take a big breath of it, too. It goes in your body. Remember that the nose goes directly into the brain, straight behind, so it's going to filter it back there. Now, all of the oils in that blend, which we call Three Wise Men, are mentioned in the Bible except for spruce. And spruce is not mentioned in the Bible, but it's in that blend. And so I'm going to pass around Valor, which is another blend of oils intended to give you courage. All fragrances have an emotional impact or influence on you. And this particular blend called Valor has the effect of making you feel brave and courageous. So if you have to do something scary in the next week, like the IRS is going to audit you, or you've got to give a speech before a large audience and you're not used to that, just rub some Valor on you, on your shoulders, and breathe it and put it on your head. It'll give you courage to do that, what you have to do. Now, this particular idea of getting courage from a fragrance has been known for thousands of years. The Egyptians used these fragrances with their soldiers, and the Romans knew this, and they customarily, before their soldiers went into battle, they would give them oils like these. You rub their shoulders and let them breathe them. And then those little metal cuffs on their wrist when they're sword fighting, remember you see in the movies where the Roman soldiers have protectors on their wrist? Well, that under that is a piece of cloth. Sometimes in the movies you can see a little piece of white cloth sticking out. They soak that with these oils. So when they're fighting with a sword, they can just take a sniff of that anytime they want, and it bolsters their courage. And they were also given to the gladiators for more courageous fighting, even though they're fighting to the death. So it really does work. And valor has many other applications than courage, but that's why it's named valor. Okay, now I want to turn back to your first page of your notes. And you'll see there a list called 14 principal oils of the Bible. And by principal, I'm talking about the ones mentioned most often. And the most frequently mentioned oil of the Bible is myrrh. Next to that is frankincense. And then if you go down the list, calamus, cedarwood, cinnamon, cassia, and all the way down to rose of Sharon. And being a chemist, I couldn't help but put a little chemistry in there. And I teach a nice 6-hour course of chemistry, if you want to take it sometime. A lot of fun. You'll enjoy it. But and I have a book up here if you want to read it. And by the way, the subtitle of this chemistry book, it says The Chemistry of Essential Oils Made Simple. It's a 900-page book. I was trying to keep it short, but you just can't simplify things in a few words. It's harder to do that. But the subtitle is God's Love Manifest in Molecules. And that's what these oils are. They're God's love manifest in molecules. And the chemistry book is full of scriptures, which parallels with the science that I'm teaching in there. So anyway, you'll notice here that myrrh is mostly a kind of a compound called sesquiterpene. It's 60% of the oil. And there's about 20,000 different kinds of sesquiterpenes, but they have some common denominators. But notice frankincense is mostly another kind. They're in monoterpenes, 82%. There's a few sesquiterpenes. And then if we look at calamus, it's got a lot of ketones and phenols in it, mainly phenols. And then if we look way down there at cinnamon, it's got a lot of phenols in it. And it turns out that those three classes of compounds play a very important role in healing. The phenols, it begins with a P, cleanse receptor sites. Now your cells, and you got 100 trillion of them, all have receptor sites on their surface. Those are little gateways into the cell and back out of the cell. And if those are clogged up, then the cell can't communicate with its neighbors. It can't receive hormones and other things it's supposed to. And your body's not going to function right. So cleansing your cells is very important. You know, it says that cleanliness is next to godliness. And it truly is. And in the case of healing, the cleansing has to be there too, physically and mentally and spiritually. So anyway, there's the phenols for cleansing. That begins with a P. And then we see monoterpenes, which are reprogrammers. And then we see sesquiterpenes, which are like utilities, programs on your computer that get inside the computer and clean up the programs and throw away the whatever's in it that's keeping your programs from working right. So that's a PMS that I just described there. And you can remember it that way. And so it's a good PMS. Phenols, monoterpenes, and sesquiterpenes. I'm going to say a little bit more about monoterpenes because, you know, the book of Genesis tells us that we're created in God's image. So why don't we all have perfect health? What's wrong? Well, it's because we don't think perfect thoughts and we don't eat perfect foods and we don't live a perfect spiritual life. And in many ways, we've just kind of fallen astray and have kind of corrupted that. So if you're going to be healed, you need to get back to that perfect image. Now, how are you going to do that? Well, the phenols cleans the receptor sites, which put your body back into communication with itself. And the sesquiterpenes get all the bad programming out from the DNA and from the inside the cells. And then the monoterpenes are going to do the reprogramming. How are they going to know how to reprogram? Well, we have, every one of you, every human being that ever lived, more than what you're seeing. We have a physical body. It's, you know, solid. It's made out of 27 or 28 elements. But we also have an electromagnetic field. That's just another part of our physiology. Doctors know this. They measure that field if they get an EEG or an EKG. But that field is there all the time. And generally, most people can't see that field. I see the physical body, but all around you is a field. And some of you may see that sometimes. You can see a light around certain people, and very spiritual people. You might even see a light around their head. And you always see these pictures of the saints with the halo. And that's really their electromagnetic field. It's just so bright and so spiritual that it becomes visible to even ordinary people. Well, anyway, that electromagnetic field is where your blueprint is of God's perfection. And the oils work between both worlds. They work on the physical, and they work on that side too. And so the monoterpenes have the ability to reach up there in your electromagnetic field and pull that perfect image back into your body so it's manifesting physically. And we teach a technique called raindrop technique with the oils, and we drop those oils about 6 inches up over your back so that they fall through your field, because your field extends out several inches. And the oils react with that field, and so the healing in that technique starts before the oils ever touch your physical body.
Wow.
And we teach that technique, and we see miracles all the time with that. I'm going to tell you about one, yeah.
So I was just thinking, should you recommend doing raindrop frequently? Because we don't always know if things are cleaned up or...
Yeah. Getting raindrop regularly is a very good practice. And if you want to know where our classes are, we teach about 200 seminars a year. They're going on all the time, all over the world. And I haven't looked at the calendar, but if you go to raindroptraining.com and go to the calendar, you can see what's going on and where. Tomorrow night, same room right here, I'm going to do a raindrop demonstration. And explain to you how that works, and we'll draw a name of somebody and do an actual raindrop on that person. So if you want to be in the drawing, be here tomorrow night. Put your name in the pot. Yes?
And when you say I'm doing it regularly, what do you mean? Once a week?
Well, people that are not in good health, it would behoove them to get a raindrop every week for a while. And I can even tell you a case of a Lou Gehrig's disease that was cured with raindrop. Took a year, and she got a raindrop every day for several months, and then every several days, and after a year she was cured. And she came to our class after that year and learned how to do raindrop. The year before, her hands were paralyzed. She couldn't even walk. And then she came and learned how to do it. So it's just that kind of a miraculous thing. In fact, let me tell you a story about raindrop. My wife and I learned how to do the technique. We had to go to Canada to learn it. Dr. Gary Young, who's the man who originated it, was doing a seminar up there in September of 1999. And we thought, well, we want to learn that technique. So we drove up, and my wife and I, and one friend, or three of us in the car, and we learned that technique. Now, up to that point, which is in 1999, I had had chronic back pain. Sometimes fairly severe, it put me up for the day and I couldn't even work. Because I had an injury a long time ago in 1956 when I was a farm laborer up in northern Illinois, and I was a pea picker. I was working for Del Monte Canning Company picking peas, and I strained myself, and the pain never went away for the next 43 years, and I couldn't even sleep in a bed for more than a few hours, and then I'd wake up with pain. I'd go sit in a reclining chair and spend the rest of the night and then I'd go back to bed. So we had a recliner right there in the bedroom right next to it. Well, we took this training up there on how to do raindrop technique, and my back was hurting me the whole time, but once the deal has been hurting for 43 years, what's another few days? And I didn't ever volunteer to receive the technique while we were training because I wanted to learn it. So I was practicing and reading and learning how to do it. So when we got home, it was the last week of September, 1999, we had been practicing on everybody that we could get to lie still on a massage table for an hour. It takes about an hour. And I said, Lee, that's my wife, said, Lee, you know, we've been doing this on everybody, but I have never received it myself. Would you please do a raindrop on me tonight before we go to bed? So she said, okay. So she did the technique, and I went to bed, went right to sleep, and I didn't wake up till the next morning. And that is when I realized I had been instantaneously cured. I've never had pain since then. That was 14 years ago. And it was an instant miraculous healing. From one application, we use 9 different oils, and we'll do that. We'll show you how to do that tomorrow night. Well, I knew that God had asked me to teach people about these oils. He actually came to me in a vision and said, I want you to do this all over the world. At the time it came to me, I was completely ignorant about the oils. I didn't know anything about them. And I certainly didn't have any plans of changing careers at that point. But when he told me, I want you to do this if you're willing to, I said, well, God, I'll do it. But you're going to have to teach me because I don't know anything about this Toronto. Yeah. And so I agreed, and I had a company that I owned, and so I turned the company over to my son so I would be free. And I began reading books and taking seminars and getting all the training I could. And in the process, God taught me everything I know since 1999. And so, anyway, that was a miraculous and instantaneous healing for me with the raindrop technique. And so when I got that, I thought, okay, God, you want me to teach about these oils? I think you want me to teach raindrops. So that's that gave me a sense of direction. I just didn't know. There's so many oils and so many things. I didn't know where to focus. So from that point forward, I focused on raindrop, and we have trained probably several thousand people over the years, and I've taught 70 other people to teach raindrops, so I'm not the only one now. So we reach thousands of people all over the world with that technique. It's a simple technique. Anybody can do it. I think every house and home in the world needs to have some member of that family that can do raindrop, because it does marvels for just so many different conditions. So anyway, for me it was back pain. And it was all over after one raindrop. So now let's turn to page 6 of your notes. And we're going to go through the 12 oils of ancient scripture, which reminds me, let's see, hand me that box there. The oils are all in there. How many of you guessed what is in my anointing bottle? Anybody know what's in there? Or eucalyptus? Anything else? Myrrh. Okay. Frankincense. Anything else? Jalapeno? No. Olive. Oh, there's no olive oil. No, but Galvan, well, that's right. Well, I'll tell you what it is. I do this program all over the world. I've done it in 10 different countries. When God showed me that vision and he said, I want you to teach this, and he showed pictured me on stages all over the world teaching, it all came true. I've done everything that he showed me in that vision. And so I use a lot of these kits, but there's 12 oils in there. I never run out of them at the same time, and always end up with a bunch of leftovers. So that anointing oil is my leftovers. I don't know what's in there. So you want to pull sandalwood out of there, and we'll pass it around. And let's talk a little bit about sandalwood. So all of you who are guessing oils, you're right. Whatever you said, it was in there. And of course, it changes all the time. All right, who can look up Gospel of John, chapter 19, verses 38 and 39. John 19, 38, 39. Is it right, please? Sandalwood? Yeah, aloes. It's under the name of aloes. Yeah, by the way, I should mention that the Bible calls this oil aloes, but it's actually, and a lot of people think that means aloe vera, which is something found in the Americas, so North, South, Central America. That didn't exist in the Holy Land, but the Bible translators for some reason put aloes in there. The Old Testament also mentions that oil as algum and algun, A-L-G-U-N, it's all the same oil. Every 3 years, King Solomon, and by the way, it comes from India, and he would send some boats across the ocean over to India to get the supplies of sandalwood and other things from India and bring it back. So what is an oil from India doing in the Holy Land? That's a good question. Well, almost, in fact, virtually every oil that was used in the Bible in that particular part of the world came from some other country. They didn't come from that area. There's just a few of them that actually the plants grew there. Even frankincense and myrrh don't come from the Holy Land. They come from southern Arabia, from northeast Africa, and from a couple of islands off the coast there in the Indian Ocean. And the particular plants that grow those trees, frankincense and myrrh, have to have a very special climate, which doesn't exist there in the Holy Land. So those are all imported, and sandalwood was imported from India. Now, the reason that that part of the world had access to so many oils from all over the place, because they got oils from Tibet, from Indonesia, and from Africa, a lot of places, is because of its unique geographic location. It's right on the edge, the eastern end of the Mediterranean. So if you're going from the east, west, and you want to go past there, you had to go through the Holy Land and around the Mediterranean, either down to Africa or up into Europe. If you were in Europe and you wanted to go to Africa, if you didn't have a boat, you'd have to come through there. And the same thing if you're going from Africa back up to Europe or even going east. So all of the trade routes of that day went right through the Holy Land. And so all of the oils from all over the world at that time were on the caravans and on trade routes, and the people of the Bible had access to them. And so that's why we have such a rich variety of oils in that part of the world at that time. And sandalwood was one of them. So did we get John 19, 38, 39? Yeah, okay, go ahead. Okay. Go ahead and stand up. Okay. Read it to us.
Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jews. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and alloys, about 75 pounds.
Okay, thank you. Now, 75 pounds of myrrh and sandalwood oil, if you get a current 2013 price on those, which we have because we get them, that was around $150,000 or $200,000 worth of oil, which they brought as a gift for Jesus' burial. This tells you something of the measure of the devotion and reverence they had for Jesus. It also tells you they were extremely rich to be able to bring a gift like that. They'd have to be the equivalent of millionaires today to do that. Now, sandalwood also has wonderful healing applications. One of the things that sandalwood does, is, are we passing it around? Yeah, here comes sandalwood. And when you smell it, it's gonna stimulate your brain to manufacture melatonin, which is the sleep hormone. And sometimes people have sleep problems, and so we recommend that they take a little sandalwood oil and put some on their pillow and maybe anoint their heads with it, and they'll get a good night's sleep that way. My son applied that with his children when they were babies and less than 4 years old. He had five of them, and he would anoint them with sandalwood and put some on their pillows, and they would go to sleep and sleep through the night. So that might be a handy thing to know. If you might use it yourself. Okay, let's move on to the next. There's lots and lots more I can say about sandalwood. But in the Bible, it's called aloes or algoon or algum. The next one that I want to talk about is cassia. So let's pass around cassia oil. So we're still waiting for sandalwood in the back there? Yeah, okay, great. Cassia is in the cinnamon family. And when you smell it, it smells just like cinnamon, only it's much more powerful than cinnamon. The compound in cinnamon oil that has such a strong, unique fragrance and taste is transcinnamic aldehyde. That's a chemical. And cassia has twice as much a concentration of that compound as cinnamon has. So you might call cassia super cinnamon. Have you ever eaten these little red hot candies that bite your tongue with the cinnamon? Well, a cassia is a super red hot. And if you want to try a little bit, you feel free to do it, but it is very hot. So you want to take just a tiny bit, and you wouldn't want to take a drop of it. Just put a little on your finger, put it on your tongue, and that's enough. For about the first 30 or 60 seconds, you think that's really good, and then it starts burning. And but anyway, it is also a local anesthetic, so if you swallow any of it too much, it will paralyze your larynx, and you won't be able to talk for about 20 minutes. But it's one of my favorite oils. I like to put a drop in my drinking water and mix it up real good. It really flavors drinking water really well. Now, the next one I want to talk about is cedarwood. And so we start passing that one around whenever we can. And how many of you have a cedar chest or a cedar closet or maybe some cedar drawers in your dining room or bedroom? The reason that we have that is to keep the moths away. It keeps the insects out. It is an insecticide. And that's been known for thousands of years. The Egyptians knew that. And they understood the insecticidal properties of it. If you had enough money, they also made your coffin out of cedar wood, which was supposed to help preserve the mummies longer. But there's no cedar growing in Egypt. They had to go up to Lebanon and then import it. But besides its insecticidal properties, cedarwood also, when you smell it, energizes your brain so that you can remember things better. And if you're studying in college or in school or trying to cram for an exam or something, if you will be breathing cedarwood while you're studying, you'll remember much more when it comes to the time for the test, especially if you bring some cedarwood with you to the test. And when you smell that, it will cause your mind to recall all the stuff you studied.
Who know and love him. in spirit and in truth. Welcome to the throne.